Hello to you, hello to all. I hope you are doing better than the world.
Why do the borders of the U.S. federal capital form a square, landlocked between the states of Maryland and Virginia?
The boundaries of Washington, District of Columbia, the federal capital of the United States of America, follow the shapes of a square. In this talk, we will explain the origins of this unusual shape. On July 4, 1776, in the midst of the War of Independence against the Kingdom of Great Britain, 13 American colonies declared their independence and officially became the United States of America. These 13 colonies are called Virginia, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Maryland, Connecticut, Rhode Island, Delaware, North Carolina, South Carolina, New Jersey, New York, Pennsylvania, Georgia, and extend over nearly 2,000 kilometers from north to south along the Atlantic Ocean and east of the Appalachian Mountains. With the signing of the Paris Peace Treaty in September 1783, after 8 years of war, Great Britain officially recognized the independence of the United States of America. A constituent convention, made up of representatives from the 13 former colonies, meets in Philadelphia to write a constitution. This was ratified in 1788, after the agreement of the various states, with the exception of the states of North Carolina and Rhode Island. Each state designated electors who, in turn, were to elect the new president. In February 1789, these electors chose George Washington as the first president of the United States. The first Congress elected under the Constitution met in New York in March, and George Washington took office at the end of April after being sworn in New York. Between 1774 and 1800, the United States Congress met in several places, most often in Philadelphia, but also, among others, in Baltimore, York, Lancaster, Princeton, Annapolis, or New York, the first years to outwit the British troops. The presidency and government did not move to Washington until 1800, 17 years after independence was won. In addition to the executive, the legislative, with Congress, and judicial, with the Supreme Court, powers reinforced the new federal power installed in Washington, D.C. George Washington, the first president, whose second presidential term ended in March 1797, died a few weeks before the installation of the Capitol in Washington, D.C., and he will not have taken advantage of the proximity between his property of Mount Vernon and the site of the Capitol. The choice of the location of the federal administration was the subject of multiple negotiations on the part of the different states, with the states of the South opposed to the states of the North, each wishing to defend their own interests. The search for a consensus on a point of agreement was long and spread over many years. It stirred up rivalries between the cities. Candidates from New York or Boston suffer from their remoteness from the southern states at a time when travel times are long. Finally, the Congress voted for a compromise, and the Act of Residence of July 16, 1790 fixed the location of the territory of the future capital according to the following criteria. A territory not exceeding 10 miles per side. On the banks of the Potomac River. Between its tributaries the Anacostia, named East Branch in the deed, and the Conococheague, named Conococheague in the deed, both on the left bank of the Potomac, in the territory of Maryland, either on a slider about 60 miles long, or on the order of nearly 100 kilometers. This act also provides that it is up to the president to choose the final location of the territory on which the capital is to be erected. That the president must do everything possible so that the government and the Congress can settle in their new buildings in Washington, D.C. on December 1, 1800. And that, in the interim, the government and Congress will sit in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, for a period of 10 years. This 10-year deadline was set for two main reasons. Philadelphia was a very serious suitor with solid arguments to make to obtain the installation of the capital. This transitional period was seen as a kind of compensation. On the other hand, the new capital had to be built ex nihilo, and a delay of 10 years was not a luxury. It should be noted that this law was passed narrowly, with a very narrow majority, both in the Senate, by 14 votes against 12, and in the House of Representatives, by 31 votes against 29. As we have just noted, the choice of the precise location of the territory was left to the final judgment of George Washington, 1732 to 1799, the first President of the United States, since April 1789. Originally from Virginia, an owner of a plantation on the banks of the Potomac less than 25 kilometers downstream from the planned location of the future capital, George Washington knows the region perfectly well. His choice fell on a territory of a square shape with sides 10 miles, or 16 kilometers, long, the angles of which are directed north, east, south and west with respect to at its center, encompassing the existing cities of Georgetown in Maryland and Alexandria, on the right bank of the Potomac in Virginia, as well as a few small villages, such as Hamburg and Carrollsburg, near the confluence of the Potomac and Anacostia. What Congress did not anticipate was that George Washington was not going to fix the location of the territory according to the voted criteria. The site proposed by the president overflows into the territory of Virginia, on the right bank of the Potomac, by integrating the city of Alexandria into the territory of the district, which was not planned. In addition, he proposes to encompass both banks of the Anacostia River at its point of confluence with the Potomac, when he should have limited himself to its right bank. In order to give a legal framework to the choice made by the president, the final location of the district had to be ratified by a vote in Congress, which was done in 1791. The choice of location for the new territory was wise and had many natural advantages. The Potomac is navigable up to the territory of the new district, allowing boat traffic. The ports of Alexandria and Georgetown, one on each shore, constitute an important economic base for a large city. And the location of the territory was central to the Northwest and Southwest territories of the United States. The portion west of the Potomac, ceded by Virginia, consists of 31 square miles. The district on the left bank of the Potomac, ceded by Maryland, has an area of 69 square miles. George Washington, in a written proclamation made in March 1791, fixed only the location of the base of the square which the new federal district was to cover, at Jones Point, on the shore of Virginia, and the starting angle of the first two sides of this square, 45 degrees east and west to north, and the length of each side, 10 miles. Then, he transferred the implementation of this geometric figure on the ground to a team of topographers. The establishment of the boundaries of the territory fell, against all odds, to Benjamin Banneker, an African-American tobacco planter, a freed slave, with solid credentials in the fields of mathematics, science, watchmaking and astronomy, although completely self-taught. Topographers surveyed the border between the federal territory and the states of Virginia and Maryland. After precise readings of the movements of the stars and numerous calculations, milestones were set up at each mileage point, i.e. 40 marks in all, including 14 on the border with Virginia. This task was not easy insofar as the territory was undeveloped, covered with forests, swamps, and dotted with a few vineyards and tobacco plantations. A ceremony was organized in April 1791 on the occasion of the installation of the first marker, the southernmost one, on the right bank of the Potomac, referenced SW1, before Southwest N degree 1. This terminal is now located inside a disused lighthouse at Jones Point. The bollards, made with stone quarried from the same quarry used to build the White House or the Capitol, have the inscription "Jurisdiction of the United States" on one side and the name of the border state, Virginia, or Maryland, on the other. They are dated 1791. Or 1792, depending on the year of installation. Most of these border markers are still in place, but some are not accessible because they are placed on private, public or military property, such as markers Northwest 4 and Northwest 5. The name Washington District of Columbia was given to this new territory, obviously in homage to the first president of the United States, George Washington, and in commemoration of Christopher Columbus, the discoverer of America. At the time of its founding, the District of Columbia was divided into two distinct counties, Washington County, on the Maryland side, northeast of the Potomac, and Alexandria County, on the Virginia side, southwest of the Potomac. An amendment to the Act of Residence, 1791, prohibited the erection of public buildings in the territory ceded by Virginia. The federal buildings were therefore built on the territory ceded by Maryland, which is the case of the White House, the Capitol, the seat of Congress, or the Supreme Court building. This concentration meant that the territory ceded by Virginia benefited less from the economic boom experienced in the former territory of Maryland. The Pentagon, the building housing the United States Department of Defense, was built much later, inaugurated in 1943, on territory returned to Virginia. Developing the foundations of a nascent democracy from a blank sheet, such was the challenge offered to the representatives of the executive and legislative powers installed in Washington, D.C. And that was no small feat. With the establishment of the new federal capital, a new step was taken, after the Declaration of Independence, the adoption of a constitution, and the election of a first president. But there was still so much to do. Thus, it was still necessary to give a legislative framework to the new district, to fix the conditions of expropriation of the few private landowners who were installed there, to determine the conditions of compensation of the states of Virginia and Maryland for the land ceded, and so many other pending issues. Thomas Jefferson, the future third president of the United States, after George Washington and John Adams, was very active in the reflection and the drafting of the new statutes to determine the mode of operation of the district. He advocated the creation of an enclave detached from the states of Maryland and Virginia in order to avoid conflicts of interest. This independence of the capital was to avoid any interference between the local powers and the federal powers. The mode of operation of the new district was decided in the Organic Law of 1801. Here are the main points. The district reports directly to Congress and is not considered a federal state. All citizens residing within the boundaries of the district are no longer attached to the state of Maryland or the state of Virginia, but to the district. The citizens of the district no longer have elected representatives in Congress, and therefore can no longer influence the laws that govern them. In the decades following the establishment of this law, there were increasing calls for the return of district lands to the original states. Discontent grew over the loss of representation in Congress. This movement was topical in 1822, when a bill was introduced to request the retrocession of the city of Alexandria to the state of Virginia and the city of Georgetown to the state of Maryland. This request was granted unsuccessfully by Congress. This subject came up very regularly on the agenda, but was never to be approved until 1847. These demands became insistent as citizens residing in the territory ceded by Virginia complained of the following: not benefiting from the economic boom encountered on the other side of the Potomac. Not be represented in Congress, as are the citizens of all states. The lack of infrastructure investment granted by Congress, which accelerated the decline of the port of Alexandria in favor of that of Georgetown, on the other shore. Fear of the abolition of slavery in the territory of the District of Columbia. Indeed, the port of Alexandria was then a hub of the slave trade. This business flourished with plantation owners in the southern United States. Merchants settled in the port of Alexandria, in the former territory of Virginia, feared for the prosperity of their trade following increasingly insistent rumors that slavery would be abolished in the territory of the District of Columbia. They campaigned for the retrocession of Alexandria County to Virginia, this militant state for the maintenance of slavery. For the time being, this fear was unfounded, the slave trade in the district being finally abolished only in 1850, while maintaining the right of ownership of a slave. The abolition of slavery in the District of Washington was effective in April 1862, a few months before its abolition in all the states of the United States, in 1865, with the promulgation of the 13th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. after a long process required to obtain the various agreements at both the federal and state level, the entire portion on the right bank of the Potomac was finally returned to the state of Virginia in March 1847, more than a year after this had been approved by unanimous vote by the Virginia General Assembly. Since this restitution, the county of Washington, on the side of Maryland, constitutes in itself the territory of the federal district. The district is under the direct supervision of Congress, and as such is not considered a federal state. Taxation without representation is a political slogan that is regularly found in Washington. Thus, most car license plates bear it. The Constitution, in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 17, does not provide for the ability of residents to vote in legislative and presidential elections. However, there is a slow evolution of the rights of these citizens. Since 1960, the people of Washington have been granted the right to have representation in Congress, but without the right to vote. In 1964, Washingtonians were allowed to vote for the first time. The 23rd Amendment to the Constitution, ratified in March 1961, gives Washingtonians the right to vote in presidential elections. It grants the capital 3 electors, the equivalent of the number the district would be entitled to if it were a state. On November 3, 1964, Washingtonians voted for the first time in the presidential election, with a remarkable turnout of 89.2% and an equally remarkable leaning towards Lyndon Johnson, who garnered 85% of the vote. Since 1973, the city has been allowed to elect its own mayor. What citizens are demanding today is no longer a retrocession to the state of Maryland, but quite simply the status of a federal state, with the rights and duties that go with it, no more, no months. It would then be the smallest state by area, but not the least populated, Wyoming and Vermont being less so.
I hope you had a great time, found the topic interesting, and learned something. If so, consider subscribing to my channel. And I say to you, see you next time.